All right. Jackey, welcome. This is the other podcast. It's typically a show where on Thursday nights, I'll record with a friend of mine and then planning got sorted out so that you're recording now. So he's not available, so it's just you and me.
Okay.
To the people who are listening, who will be listening, this is Jackey Neyman-Jones, Jackey Jones. I got reached out to you via email. Typically, this podcast is just we have conversations. Again, usually I have a co-host here, and if I don't, I just have a conversation with whoever I'm talking to here. So what I'll do is let you introduce yourself however you like.
Okay. Yeah, I'm Jackey Neyman-Jones, and best known in the world to Mystery Science Theater fans. I was in a film as a child that my entire family was involved in, Monos, The Hands of Fate. And it was made in 1966, and it disappeared for 27 years for good reason. It wasn't a very good film. And then it showed up one day in 1993 on Mystery Science Theater. And my dad, who starred in the original film, was a Mystery Science Theater fan and happened to be watching that day and saw it and was very surprised. And since then, it's had quite a life and continues to keep growing. But my dad was also an artist, and I'm an artist. I've been a professional independent or self-employed artist my whole life, with various businesses, and I've worked with some nonprofits, and I'm currently creating an artist co-op that's kind of a hybrid between profit business and nonprofit organization. So we're going to be writing a lot of grants, and it's all about community collaboration. So this thing is a lifelong dream, and I've done things like this in the past, but this is like, you know, the pinnacle. I do a lot of things. I'm one of them ADD people, you know, an artist, creative, and I drive myself crazy because I have like 7 projects at any given time. But
I know that feeling all too well.
There you go.
Right now I'm working with this, the other podcast, something that me and my friend just started up in this past summer. It's kind of something to do. That's when we talk about community stuff. I've been working on I call it my 20-year project. It just seems so big. It's very community-based and trying to get businesses in the community working to empower the community, and the community members being able to support themselves without relying on a whole lot of outside work. And been interested in music as of late, and trying to get my own like fitness online coaching thing going. So yeah, I completely get that bunch of juggling things.
Yeah,
but it keeps us busy.
Oh, busy, that's for sure. Definitely. And I just got a new puppy, so she keeps me busy too.
Oh, nice. How old is she?
Well, her birthday was August 6th, so 2 months.
Mm-hmm. Have you been like a dog person throughout your life, or?
Oh, both. But my dog in that film, Monos, The Hands of Fate, it was a Doberman. And his name was Shanka, which is a Native American word that basically means dog, which is interesting because Monos means hand. So the film title is redundant, and so is the dog's name. But I had a second Shanka a few years ago, and he was actually a Chihuahua American Eskimo mix. Oh. And then he died last year, and I have a cat who's a year old now, but I just got this puppy, and she's so dang cute. She when I was posting pictures of her a few weeks ago, everybody said, oh, I love Rottweilers. And I'm like, no, she's a Chihuahua. So, but she's black and she's got the tan markings like a Rottweiler or like a Doberman. So I named her, she's Shonka. She's Shonka 3. Shonka. And, yeah, but she's like teeny tiny little thing, and but she's all spirit. In fact, a friend who was babysitting her today while I was running around said she almost got killed by a big Siamese cat crossing the yard because she went challenging this thing, and it was at least three times her size. She's yeah, we have wild turkeys here. I live in Western Oregon, and we've got deer. And so she's going after everything, getting the riding lawnmower, you know.
Yeah, we got that. I live out in Maine. And recently, we've had a lot of turkeys in our area as well. So,
okay.
Well aware of that wildlife coming through. And I'm not even that rural of an area, but.
Yeah, well, we are. We're in a little tiny town of 1,000 people in rural Western Oregon, about 70 miles from Portland.
Wow.
Oregon. Portland, Oregon.
The other Portland,
yes.
So you were saying your dad was in the movie and your dog was in the movie, your whole family was in that movie. What was that? That's kind of cool. How old were you when you guys made that?
I was 6 years old during the filming, and I played the child. I wrote a book about it called Growing Up with Manos, the Hands of Fate, how I was the child star of the worst movie ever made and lived to tell the story. This film is taught in film schools. It's everything not to do in filmmaking, the synchronicity, the editing, everything. But, you know, it's so beloved. It's like the fans hold tight to that bad movie image. There's something about it that really resonates with people. It may be a very low budget film, one of the first independent films ever, if not the first independent film made in El Paso, Texas in the 60s. You know, for all they didn't have, they did a pretty amazing job. I mean, some of the actors were in community theater. My dad was one of them, and he was cast as the lead role of the master of this polygamous cult, you know, so he had like six wives. And then me as a child, I was traveling with my family through the desert. We get lost and end up at this place. And so it's this whole story about this family that took my dad was in community theater, and most of the actors came from the play he was in at that time, which was Henry IV. My dad was playing the lead role, and Best Actor of the Year award for that play in 1966, the same year that Manos was made.
The juxtaposition.
Yeah. And I also like to say that my book is 4.5 stars on Amazon. So it's a really good book about a really bad movie.
That's awesome.
But you know, the most amazing thing about this film to me is all the really talented projects that have been inspired by it over the years. And because of that, I've had so many opportunities to be part of many of these projects and to meet people that turn into other projects and other collaborations. And it's just been incredible. Like there's Manos, the Hands of Felt, which is a puppet theater. They did a play from Seattle, Washington, and you can see it on YouTube for free. Manos, the Hands of Felt. It's hilarious. And then there's at least 4 stage productions that have happened.
Wow.
Wow. And one of them was in Chicago called Manos, the Rock Opera of Faith. I never saw that one. But there was one done in Portland, Oregon. And I found out they were doing it before it started. And I contacted them and they invited me. I got to participate in that. Wow. I've done a sequel, Manos Returns, which is on Tubi, I believe, for free. And I'm working on another show called The Manos Chronicles, which is a web series, and it's very good. And you can see the trailer on YouTube. And I can send you all these links as well.
Oh, great, great. Yeah, I'll definitely post that up with them. So with the Manos Chronicles, is that like continuing the story of that, or, you know?
Yeah, and so is Manos Returns. I mean, one of the amazing things about this whole film is, you know, the original storyline is it's a decent story, but the script and everything, it was very thin, you know, and people have use their imagination and taken it off in so many directions. I mean, there's coloring books, there's trading cards, there's video games. There's so many projects that have been inspired by this. But
rights to Manos, guess it seems like there's
but that's the thing, is the only reason it ever came back into the world and didn't disappear forever was because it was missing a trademark. Hmm. And Mystery Science Theater only does movies that are in public domain.
Right.
So they wouldn't have touched it if it had been protected.
Yeah.
And so therefore it's open, you know, I mean, unless somebody, you know, protects their own individual thing, but for the most part, it's a free for all, and it's a lot of fun. I mean, I sell the master's robes, the robe that my father wore. It's black, big, giant red hands on the front, and like a minister, but a dark priest, you know. Yeah. And I make those signed, numbered. Custom. In fact, I'm working on two right now. I'm working on number 50 and number 51.
Wow.
I committed to making 100 of them, which is crazy.
You're almost over the halfway mark.
Oh, whew, yeah, barely. But I'm getting better at it. I'll tell you, you make 50 of those things, you get pretty good.
I'll see 100 then.
but in terms of, I'm calling it the Manosverse, like multi-universe, because Manos Returns story is the sequel, but it's basically the story of what would have happened to the little girl, me, if she had stayed with that polygamous cult. Because at the end of the film, not to spoil it, but the child and her mother are kept by the polygamous cult. So, you know, you get this idea that the little girl is going to be the next wife. So it's upsetting to some people, because I'm wearing a dress that just like the big girls, you know. And so Manos Returns is the story of, if Debbie stayed with the cult, what would have happened to her? Or what would a child be like that had been raised in that environment for 50 years? So it's 50 years later, and in Manos Returns, I am now the master. I have taken over. So I'm not a very pleasant person because of the kind of the way I've been raised. But on the, you know, but also now I've got all these women that I have no use for, you know, so they're kind of irritating, and so I'm not really pleasant in Manos Returns. And then in the Manos Chronicles, it's a completely different story. Like, what if little Debbie, the character, escaped the Bally Lodge as a child, and she's been in hiding for all those years, and so now she's decided to come out, and she's doing good in the world, and she's getting retribution. So yeah. It's a whole different character.
That sounds awesome. I'm really interested in all of that now. I'm going to dive into the Punisverse.
There you go. Yeah, well, I coined that term. I think it'll catch on because it's crazy. Yeah, once you look into it, it's just like, for instance, my dad did all the artwork and the props in the film as well. My mother made the original costumes and she taught me to sew. So I'm now making the master's robes just like she made the original. And my dad painted the master and dog painting and he did all the props. And so I have recreated his paintings and I sell prints of them on my Etsy right now. And I was commissioned a few years ago by a fan to do the master and dog. The master is Frank Zappa with his poodle instead of the master with his Doberman. And so I painted Frank Zappa and his poodle, and I love that one. And now I'm doing online painting classes. I do monthly Mystery Science Theater inspired painting classes.
Oh, cool.
And that's going so well that we added a second series of classes that are non-Mystery Science Theater. Because I've been teaching the painting parties, the painting at the bars and stuff for like 7-8 years. So we moved it online.
Those are so fun. I've done one of those with my wife and came back. It's interesting to see when you're doing it with somebody else and see the different paintings and how they come out, even though you're painting the same thing.
I love it. I love it so much because I always get somebody in one of my classes that makes sure that I know that they can't draw a stick figure. You know, I've heard that so many times. I'm like, yeah, whatever. I mean, we're just here to play. I mean, we're just playing. And the truth is, some of the people who've never painted before, they do stuff. I walk around like, that's so cool. I mean, I'm a better artist because of all the things I've stolen from beginners.
Yeah, I mean, it's the whole like inspiration part of it all anyway. Like, look at the Manosphere. Like, everything kind of spawns from that one thing going through and building upon it. And it's funny talking about all that. I immediately think I want to do Manos in space. I want to do some sort of space version.
Oh, I like that. I love Star Trek. I love science, and I mean, I love the whole thing about different universes, multiverses, and so this. Yeah, I'd love to see that. Hey, there's Manos, the band of Fate. They just came out with their new album.
Really? That sounds cool, too. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm gonna go on a deep dive after this.
I'll send you a bunch of links. I'll get you started.
Awesome. So what else have you been up to?
Gosh, with... boy... That's a lot. I mean, starting this co-op right now is taking a huge amount of time. And it's because the timing is right. We're creating this co-op in the next town over from me. It's about 18,000 people. And it's traditionally been pretty conservative, white bread kind of community and old boy network, and things have been changing for a long time, but really slowly. And we had this opportunity in this beautiful historic building. It's an old JCPenney's. It was built in 1910, I believe, and no, 1913. And it was a JCPenney's from 1923 to 1989. And it's this beautiful, like, craftsman and Victoria, just a lot of dark wood and mezzanines. And so with the co-op, we're opening up to all the arts. I mean, we're doing a co-op where we're going to jury in high-end artists, but we're also going to do like a community art night that's free, mm-hmm. that people can come, like the old quilting bees, where people just come and they bring their projects, or they just come and hang out and see what everybody else is doing, you know, no pressure. We're going to do a night a month for local independent filmmakers. We went to a movie night. Mm-hmm. We talked to the senior center about some of their elders coming and telling us some stories. Some of the local history. Besides, and then classes, we're teaching, whoops, hold on. Oh my God. That's funny. I don't know if you hear that, but.
Is that the theme song?
Yeah, my ringtone is actually the most. Stop. It's, when you look up Monos, look up the Torgo. That's the Torgo sound. So when the character Torgo stumbles through the set, that's always, anyway, every time it goes off in Walmart, I'm like, oh my God.
You have people poking their
that's
heads around.
That's my life.
Not recognizing it.
See, I got all distracted then. We've got a lot going on. We're writing grants. The city I live in is only 1,000 people, and it's at the end of the road, and it's low income, and so we're looking at writing grants that join the communities and that help bring culture and opportunity, especially to the kids. You know, we want to be able to have the kids participate in all types of cultural events and get outside of their own community and see things going on in the world. I mean, there's so many talented people around here that are just kind of hidden away. They haven't had the opportunity. The closest big town is Salem, Oregon, and that's, you know, 35, 40 minute drive. And, you know, the people here just don't feel so connected necessarily.
Hmm. So a co-op, and I hear that word all the time, and I think it means different things for different people. Is that generally like with your art co-op, it's just going to be these artists coming in and sharing that space to be able to, you know, build up and do those things that you talked about, right?
Yeah, we're setting it up like an art gallery where they jury in people and you have a choice. You can be a member, which means you're going to get a higher commission on the art that you sell, but you have a commitment to a job within the space, you know, whether it's gallery sitting, you know, to be there, or maybe clean up, or I mean, we have to decide how many members and the different jobs. So, but these are people that are committed to being part of it. And then people who don't have the time, but commission the gallery, you know, we get a higher commission because mm-hmm. we're doing more of the work. So we're setting it up a lot like an art gallery, but we're working under the local umbrella of the Dallas Arts Association. So we're going to be a combination for-profit business working with the nonprofit so that we can, I mean, like, for instance, we're collaborating with, we've gone to all the stores in the downtown area and told them what we're doing. And so like the local restaurants, we want to have, there's a beautiful bar in there. We want to have some of the local wineries who don't have a tasting room maybe come in and during some painting party nights, maybe they come in and they do some wine tasting.
Yeah.
You know, we met somebody who's a yoga instructor. And then I met another woman who fosters puppies. And it's like, what about yoga and puppies, you know? And those, some of those puppies might end up going home with somebody, you know.
That's a really good thing.
The possibilities are endless for somebody who is always thinking endlessly.
Yeah. That's what's the joy of being a creative. Go ahead.
And yeah.
Others ideas.
But you know, I'm just used to a lot of times. I have ideas and I'm trying to get things off the ground on my own. And I always say I play well with others. I always do so much better when I have business partners and, you know, you're splitting up the duties and different people have different skills. And that's what's happening right now. It's just like magic. People are begging to be part of this thing. I mean, like a woman came in, she wants to do ballroom dancing. How cool is that? You know?
That's awesome. You're contracting it all right now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's a little overwhelming. So I just try and breathe. Just breathe.
Well, that's great. Well, you know, it's we've been talking for a while, and I think you've got a lot on your plate. And I think I heard dinner being called downstairs. So.
Yeah. I need to get going on that, too.
But great talking with you, Jackie. You're going to send me over those links.
Yes, I'm going to do that right now before I forget.
And before we go, if you want to say anything that you believe on.
Yeah, look up Dumb-Industries. I'm collaborating with him, with Chris, it's Mystery Science Theater related, but that's where I'm doing my online painting classes. And there's just a number of things going on there, and you'll find me there. So really promoting those classes. It's exciting and it's growing. And I'm just having so much fun doing this. So, I will send you those links so you can get them out.
Awesome. Well, I hope we can talk again sometime, Jackie.
Yeah, I'd love to. Thank you so much and have a great evening.
Thank you too. Bye.